Let's see, one second that I confirm that the streaming starts. Yeah, there, we are online now. Okay, so thanks a lot, Mari. It's a great pleasure that we have her as a speaker, and we are extremely lucky to have her. She's an expert on many, many things, going from high energy cosmic rays, photons, then dark matter, and also neutrinos. And she will be talking about the Juno experiment today. And yeah, without taking more time from your time slot, yeah, please start, Mari. And thank you very much for participating in the school.
Thank you, Javier. Thanks, everybody. And hello, everybody. And thanks for the invitation. I'm very happy to be actually to participate to this school. Let me see. Do you see my screen?
Yes.
Yes.
So I want just to talk today about this the Juno experiment. This is actually an experiment that I'm working in since 2016 or 2017. As Javier said before, I was working on Auger in the past, so it was a pleasure to listen to some of the lectures that you had in the past day, especially the ones in Spanish, that it was like good memories coming back. Since today is the last day of the school, in the next slides, I suppose that you learn, you know already something about neutrinos, but you can interrupt me if you have questions. Especially this will be helpful for me, because talking for 1 hour and a half alone is sometimes I could get bored by myself. So that's don't hesitate to make questions. So now let's start with the talk. It's the first thing that I would ask you if we were in presence is what is Juno? So if I ask such a question, probably the first thing that you would try to do is to Google, and I try to do this exercise and to check on Google. And actually, this was actually because I wanted to find some very cool picture, and this is what I came out. So it seems that there is a nice comedy called Juno. I will check during holidays. And there is also a mission from NASA that is called Juno. So I'm not going to talk about any of this topic, unfortunately, maybe. So if we really want to know the topic today, it's better to ask something more like Juno experiment or Juno neutrino. This works much better. So you see here that we can find out basically all things about the experiment I'm going to talk to you about. So still with this question, what is Juno? I want to give you only one sentence. And this doesn't mean that the talk finish here. That's just a really brief summary that would be nice if you at least you keep in mind some keywords about Juno. So Juno means GMN Underground Neutrino Observatory. GMN is the town in China where this experiment is going to be built. And Underground Neutrino Observatory is quite easy to understand. It is a multi-purpose medium baseline reactor neutrino experiment. We typically start always with a sentence like this. Sometimes we also can say that it's a 20 kiloton liquid scintillator detector, or we can specify some other information like that we aim to determine the mass ordering of neutrinos, or that the detector is under construction in China. But there are a few keywords that I underlined here that I want to stress a little bit, because they contain more information than what it's what may look like. So it's first of all this multi-purpose. What it means? So Juno is designed for mass ordering, but actually it can do much more, and it can do a very rich physics program. And you will see in the next slides that we can actually do particle physics, but also beyond standard model physics, astrophysics, geophysics. There is a very rich program behind. And then there is this magic word, medium baseline, that you probably heard in the past days. This is something very common in the neutrino community to define the experiment based on the distance between the detector and the main neutrino source. So in the past days, you learned about some experiments like CONI. These are experiments that are called very short baseline experiments because they are only a few meters far from the detector, from the nuclear reactor. Then we have short baseline experiments that are the ones, those like Daya Bay or Double Show, that are hundreds of meters far from the reactor. We have this medium baseline. Medium means, in this case, will mean tens of kilometers. And then we have the long baseline that are hundreds of kilometers, like Dune or T2K. So actually, this distance is not only the information about the distance, but it's basically an information on the type of oscillation that we want to study. And then finally, there is this reactor neutrino information that is surely it's the information about which type of neutrino we want to detect with Juno. But as Guillermo explained you a few days ago, it's basically it also tells you that we are going to focus on electron antineutrinos. And okay, the other information like the 20 kiloton liquid scintillator or the location are information about the detector type. You can guess from the type of the detector, you can guess also the detection technologies and the size of also the detector. But at least these three or four information are really the central part of Juno. And you will see that in the next slides that we can develop more on this on these points. So now what I am going to present, since you already know a lot of neutrino after this Kunai school, I just briefly focus or recap a few points that will be needed during the rest of the talk about something about neutron oscillation, basically. And then I will tell you why we are building Juno, and I will then concentrate a little bit more on the detector, and I will finish on the physics reach and on the status of the detector. Because as I said to you, differently from other talks that you listen already, in this case, Juno is still under construction, so this is everything will come in the next years. So let's start with the first with defining which is the energy range of interest for Juno. So you have seen already this plot. I think that it was Esteban that presented it. So this is the spectrum of the energy spectrum of neutrino, and you see here. So you have the flux on the y-axis and the energy range on the x-axis, and you have here a lot of different sources. Most of them are astrophysical origin, cosmic rays, and reactor neutrinos, antineutrinos. Juno will work in this energy range between around the MeV up to a few GeV, and this is of course the energy range of interest for reactor neutrinos. But you see that there are also a lot of other sources in this energy range. In particular, we have this solar neutrinos, these supernova burst neutrinos. We have some also the background from old supernova already exploded. We have the atmospheric neutrinos, and we have also a part of geoneutrinos. So of course, all these sources, we can all detect all of them. It's not just that we can switch off the sun or the Earth. So with all these neutrinos, we can detect all of them. And this is basically the reason why we can also be a multipurpose detector. Just also before starting, just to give you a bit the feeling of the numbers we are of these sources. So our main source will be the reactor, nuclear reactors. And I remind you, this was already in the talk of Guillermo. These nuclear reactor, they produce something around 10 to 20 neutrino per second per gigawatt of thermal power. So this is a large number of neutrinos that are produced. This we of course we give this number, this is close to the core. But then the other source that is a huge source of neutrino for us is the sun, from which we receive 10 to 10 neutrinos per second per centimeter square. And then there will be other sources that are minor sources or transient sources, like the case of supernova. Again, here, just a recap of what we have seen yesterday. I'm sorry, this is for the other speakers. This is very rough and very a sketch of what you have explained very well in the previous talks. So you know that this neutrino oscillates. You have heard for 5 days about this. So we start with the flux of a neutrino type, and after a given distance, we may end up with a mixture of different type of neutrinos. And then we can eventually get back to our original flux of pure neutrinos. So this is in a really simplified way, explaining this oscillation and what we expect to detect. And from the mathematical point of view, you have already seen that we can describe this oscillation with this PMNS matrix, which is parameterized with three mixing angle and this CP violation term. You have also seen in the previous days that we can study the oscillation, the neutrino oscillation, by looking at the probability, the oscillation probability, or the survival probability, that is just the complement. So this means that we look at the type of neutrino and we, after a given distance, we search or we calculate which is the probability that this neutrino is still in the flux. So you see here the formula, and you have seen already this formula. It depends on the two oscillation parameters, the mass splitting term and the mixing angle. And then you have this dependence on the distance and the energy of your neutrinos. This is the simplified equation in the case of two neutrino flavors. And graphically, you can see this probability with this function. So you here in this plot, you see the probability as a function of the length. If there were no oscillations, your survival probability will be 100%. So there is no change in your flux. Because of the oscillation, you will see less and less neutrinos of the original type. And this, the amplitude of this oscillation gives you basically the mixing angle, while the frequency of the oscillation is the one that is related to the mass splitting term. So now, if you want to measure this neutrino oscillation, what you would do is to place your detector in a position where you maximize the deviation from the non-oscillation case. So you typically place your detector here in the minimum of this survival probability. Now, if we move to the three flavor case, the equation, of course, gets more complicated. And if we look at the same graph, but with the three flavor, you will see something like this, where this blue line. So you recognize let's call it the slow frequency oscillation, that is the red one, basically, okay? And then you see also that are overlapped with some other fast oscillations. This is the first one, the red one, would correspond to theta 1,2, and the fast oscillation are the ones that are called, that are related to the mixing angle theta 1,3. So you see that, for example, if you want to study only theta 1,3, you would put your detector here in this case, where you maximize the difference with respect to the non-oscillation case, and you don't get other contamination from other oscillation. This is the case, for example, here it is the case of a double show. And this is what I was calling before short baseline experiments. And then we have here we have this other peak, that is the theta 1,2, and this is the region where Juno will be placed. Actually, Juno will be at the minimum of this curve here, And this is a nice, a really excellent position, because this is where we can see at the same time the slow oscillation, the red curve, and the blue oscillation, the fast oscillation that comes from theta 1-3. So this is a peculiarity of Juno. This is the first time that we can see these two oscillation modes at the same time. So again, a simplified way of now of thinking of how do we detect neutrinos. So the basic idea is that you start with a source of neutrinos. It's typically it's better, it's easier if it's a known source. In our case, it's the nuclear reactor, which is a quite nice source because you have only electron antineutrinos, so you have a pure beam, and this is for free because they are we are not producing it for us. And these electron antineutrinos, they oscillate, and after a given distance, we place our detector. And what we try to observe to measure this neutron oscillation, what we try to observe is the disappearance of the electron antineutrinos. So we measure these electron antineutrinos, and we see a reduced flux compared to the initial one. So the type of interaction that we use in this type of detector, and here depends, of course, partially from the detector, but there is one channel that we typically call it golden channel, because it's a very interesting channel in terms of cross-section, but also in terms of possibility of reducing the background. And this is the main detection channel of Juno. This is why I'm mentioning it. Yes.
We have a question from YouTube.
Wow.
I send you from the chat. So the question is, what's the energy of the neutrinos in the oscillation plot that you show for the baseline? And if there is any uncertainty on the energy and the oscillation, I mean, the oscillation.
In this plot here, okay, in this plot it was fixed by to 3 MeV, and here it's actually on the x-axis you have L over E, so that's it's a mathematical substitution with two parameters, so there is no uncertainty on the energy.
Thanks.
So so I was saying here that the inverse beta decay is the channel that we use, is the most important channel in Juno, the main channel. And this was already presented in the previous day. Here, the basic idea is that the electron antineutrino interact with the proton, with the free proton, producing a positron, the neutron. The positron lose energy and annihilate with an electrons, producing two gammas of 500 keV. And on the other side, the neutron scatters until it gets captured on hydrogen. So the hydrogen then emits photons at 2.2 MeV. So the nice thing of this IBD is that you get two signals, one that is the one coming from the positron annihilation, that is what we call prompt signal, and then we have a delayed signal that is that actually occurs with an average time of 200 microseconds in the case of Juno. And this delay time depends on your detector, but this is something nice, because using a coincidence condition between the positron, between the prompt and the delayed signal, allows you to reduce a lot of the background. So then you can imagine that the other, let's say, uncertainty in our measurement is that we want to know which is the flux at the reactors. So Guillermo already told you that there are different models. What you can also do in principle is that if you don't know nothing and you want to know which is the flux of your the original flux of your electron antineutrino at the source, you just put one order of detector just very close to the reactor, and then this is what you expect to observe. So you have the flux that you observe is a convolution between the antineutrino, the electron antineutrino flux from the reactor, and the IBD cross-section. So what you expect to observe is this red line. And the reason why I'm showing this red line, or I'm spending time on this plot, is because this, you can imagine like a measurement of the flux very close to the reactor, or if you want, is a measurement of the flux of neutrinos without oscillation. And indeed, we use this information when we want to calculate the oscillation, because we take this as a reference, and what we will observe after distance L, because of the oscillation, we will see this flux here on the bottom. The dashed line is the one that we were expecting, and you see that we have this big suppression that actually, you see this shape here of the spectrum actually reflects the survival probability in three flavors that I've shown you a couple of slides ago. So this is actually our what we will see in Juno. So this is a spoiler of what we will see now, what we expect to see in Juno. Now that you have a sketch of what we, of how things will go, let's enter a little bit more in the details of Juno. So this is a nice view of the Juno site. Here you see all the facilities that have been built for Juno. And so Juno is located in the southeast of China. You see here a map, and okay, it's 19,000 kilometers from Buenos Aires, but it's still reachable, let's say. And it is placed at 53 kilometers from two nuclear power plants. We have the Yangjian power nuclear power plant, which has six reactors, and Taishan that has two reactors, for a total power of 26 gigawatt thermal. And this is so the important point is that Juno is placed at 53 kilometers, but from both nuclear power plant. This is an important, actually crucial. A crucial point. And in the plot that I've shown you before, this corresponds actually to the minimum that we have seen before. And this is the other thing is that the detector is installed 700 meters underground. So there has been a lab that has been built, actually digged for Juno, specifically for Juno. And here you see that there is a new detector that is also under construction, that is called Tau, that is what I was mentioning before. The idea is to have a near detector. It's actually a support for Juno, even if it was not initially foreseen. So let's... This, all of what I'm going to show you in the next slides comes actually from the efforts of an international collaboration. You see here all the members. The collaboration was established in 2014, and now we have about 700 collaborators. You see also that there are some people from South America, not from Argentina, not yet at least. And then now if we go to the main goal of Juno, you know already the main goal of Juno is the neutrino mass ordering. This, you know, it's one of the biggest open questions for neutrino physics. And the main problem is that we know that we have measured the delta 1 and 1, 2. So we know that the neutrino 2 is heavier than 1, but we don't know if neutrino 3 is heavier than 2, or if it's the lightest one. So we distinguish between a normal ordering where neutrino 1, where we have neutrino 1, neutrino 2, neutrino 3 in order, and inverted ordering where neutrino 3 is the lightest one. So the main goal of Juno is to measure this difference, and this is a quite challenging measurement, and you see here why. So the idea to measure how to measure this mass ordering is to look at the neutrino spectra after oscillation, and you see that in this plot that the black curve here, a continuous black curve, is the non-oscillation spectrum. And then what we will observe are this spectrum in red or in blue, one of the two. We don't know yet. This is what we want to determine. So the red one is in the case of inverted ordering, and the blue one is the one in the case of normal ordering. And you see that basically there is a very tiny difference between these two oscillation, to these two spectra. We see the big, the slow oscillation and this fast oscillation. We really want to distinguish between the blue and the red phases. So this is a challenging measurement that requires that we know the energy very precisely, with an accuracy better than 1% and an energy resolution better than 3%. Otherwise, we can either mismatch the two lines or wash out these fast oscillations. And of course, we will need a very large detector because we want statistics to make this spectra measurement very precise enough. So this goal is precision is what actually is driving the detector design, and this is the most challenging part. So to reach this goal, what we are going to do is to build this huge liquid scintillator detector. It is actually the biggest ever built, and with also an unprecedented resolution. So these two things are actually making things very complicated, because you see here in this table how Juno compared to previous experiments. You see that is, for example, is 20 times bigger than Camland, and that is, for example, is 20 times bigger than Camland. And that, so on one side, we increase by 20 times the size, but on the other side, we also want to reduce the energy resolution by factor 2. And we also, in terms of optical coverage and light yield, we have very strict requirements. So this makes everything really complicated from the point of view of the detector construction. So how the detector is designed, it is, so we will have a huge sphere, an acrylic sphere of 35.5 meters. So you can imagine this is something like, I guess, a building of 12 floors or even more. And this sphere is filled with 20 kilotons of liquid scintillator. And all the light that is produced by this liquid scintillator, detected using a total of 40,000 PMTs. So we have 17,000 PMTs that are called large PMTs because they have a diameter of 50 centimeters. And then we have 25,000 small PMTs that are these ones, this small object here, that are actually filling the holes between the large PMTs. So they somehow they avoid losing light, but they also provide a complementary measurement, an independent measurement to somehow to reduce the systematic uncertainties. Then you can imagine this huge sphere. Then this huge sphere is immersed in a water pool that is 45 meters high, that is filled with 35 kilotons of ultra pure water. And this also, this water pool is instrumented with some PMTs you see here on the bottom, and there are also PMTs here on the metallic structure. And this is the main goal of this water pool. The main reason why it is there is to, it actually has two roles. On one side, it reduces the uncertainties coming from the rock. And on the other side, it will allows to detect muons that may cross the detector or the water pool and produce Cherenkov light inside the water pool. In addition, for this muon for the detection of muons, we also have a top tracker that are actually three layers of scintillators that are on top of the pool and allows a tracking of the muons. And we have a calibration system, of course. So I will enter in a little bit more in the details of all this part in the next slides. Okay, finally, I remind you that all this stuff is 700 meters underground, so to shield against the cosmic rays. So we now coming to a few numbers. So at least you have, again, the feeling of what we expect in Juno. So we have, with this huge detector, what we can observe, or what we expect to observe, is something like about 60 events coming from the reactor neutrinos. This, you know that this is also most because of the the very low cross section from neutrino interaction. And then you have we have a lot of other sources that are actually there we cannot remove. That is the sun with the supernova if they explode. There is also a diffuse background coming from old supernova. We have the atmospheric neutrinos. We have the muons, of course. And we have neutrinos coming from the Earth. So we have, you see here a little bit the numbers of these events. And so, of course, the reactor neutrinos is the one we are interested in. In addition to these neutrinos, we have all physical events. We have, of course, also the background. And you know this background is something that we want to avoid in our detector. It's something like fake events or uncorrelated events that mimic one of our signals. So I remind you, for VD events, what we look at is to have a prompt signal followed by a delayed signal with an average time delay of 200 microseconds. So in our time window, it may happen that we have accidental backgrounds. This means that we have, for example, two radioactivity events coming very close in time, or that we have a radioactivity event with a spallation neutron caused by an immune passing close to our detector. We can have fast neutrons entering in our detector that make a proton recoil and then they get captured. So the neutron capture is actually like the one in the IBD, and the proton capture will mimic the prompt signal. And then we have our most dangerous background that is induced by muons that can produce lithium 9 or helium 8. And in this case, these two isotopes, they decay in a neutron and beta, and so they will produce a correlated signal coming from very similar to the one from to the IBD that we want to observe. But this is something very generic that actually works for many detectors. So since now I think that is already half an hour I will talk, I do a break. And I ask you to something. So I would ask you, if you were now there designing the detector, and we know we have only 60 events that we want to detect, and we have a lot of this, all this background, how would you do, or what would you do to reduce this background? As a suggestion, there are at least 5 possible answers. And I gave already the answer in the previous slide, so it's something you can guess. And in the meantime, I take a break. So any idea of how you can reduce this type of backgrounds? Okay, I see trackers to detect muons, right? Active veto, yes, good. There was I'm just reading now that there was a question on the chat from Sergio. Oh, I will answer in a few slides. So you will get but the detection principle is basically the IBD is the dominant one, and this there will be other proton elastic scattering neutrino proton elastic scattering or neutrino electron elastic scattering that can also be used as a detection channel. But the IBD is the dominant one. So no other ideas? Okay, let's assume these experiments cost a lot. So you don't want to get bad results just because you didn't think enough. So, okay, I help you. So there are several things that are foreseen in Juno to reduce this background. So first of all, I told to you already, we put the detector underground. This reduced significantly the number of the cosmic rays and reduced significantly the number of muons. And the rate, currently the rate of muons is about 4-3 hertz. So then, Then we have the water pool. That is, as I said to you before, and someone also wrote in the chat, is actually works as an active veto. So we can reconstruct and track the immunes. And it also works against the accidental background because we can it stop gammas or neutrons coming from the rock. Then we have the TROP tracker that was already in the chat. So it's that we can use to track and reconstruct the direction of muons. And then we can, if we know the direction of muons, then we can remove all IBDs that are correlating with this direction or with the in time or in space. We also have something that I didn't mention to you before, so it was the most complicated to guess, is that we have a water buffer. So we be any element that can be radioactive, like the photomultipliers. And we put this water buffer that will stop some of the radioactivity gammas. And then we have very strict requirements on the radioactivity, so on the uranium and thorium components in the content in the liquid scintillator and in the water. And you see here that the requirements are really, really small. Like we require 10 to minus 15 gram per gram for doing our IBD search, and 10 to minus 16 gram per gram if we want to go to solar neutrinos. So this means that all the materials that we select, that we use, especially the liquid scintillator or the photomultipliers, the acrylic, everything is screened. So we check the purity of the material, we clean them, we have a complicated system of purification of the water and purification of the liquid scintillator. So everything is really controlled at a very precise level. And then we have the event selection, that is what you would do in the worst case in your detector after you build it. You try to, by doing the analysis to, for example, to ask for a space-time coincidence with the IBD, this will help removing some accidental background. You can also ask for a fiducial volume, so reject everything that is close to the border where you can have some radioactivities, and then this cut based on the track of the muon. So you can also still work with some analysis requirements. So there are all these features in Juno that are really foreseen to reduce this background. And what we, at the end, we will get here is an image of the number of events that we will we expect. And this is this the flux of the IBD events that we expect. This is this typical shape we have seen already several times. And here on the bottom, you see the expected backgrounds. And you see here that, okay, there are all the backgrounds that I mentioned, and there is something that I want to stress because it's this geoneutrinos that in this plot occurs like it is a background. Actually, it's a physical event, so that it's just a background of if we want to measure the oscillation parameters, but it's a real physical event, it's not accidental. And then in this table, you see our weak requirements and the fact that at the end, after all this structure that we have built and all the veto and the analysis cut, we can get our 60 events of IBD against 3 events of background. So this is a really nice improvement. So now I will spend a few slides just to show you a little bit more of details of the detector. There are basically 2 reasons why I'm spending time on this. One thing that it would be nice to keep in mind once this talk is finished, the complexity of this type of the experiments. They look easy on the paper, but they are really complicated when we want to build, and you will see that there are several subsystems. Basically, each of these subsystems could be an independent experiment in terms of complexity. And then the other reason why it's nice to spend also to talk about the detector is that some of us or some people likes a lot to work with the equation. Some others likes to be closer when they look at the experiment, likes to look at the detector side, some other to the analysis. So it's it's also nice to see all the facets of the of an experiment. So I start with this with the main photo sensor. So this is the photo multiplier. You know, I guess, that the photo multiplier is basically converting your light signal into an electrical signal. And here you have a nice picture showing the large PMTs and the small PMTs. And here are a few details about the large PMTs. As I said, we have 17,000 PMT in large PMTs. So we have actually two different types of PMTs that we are using. We are going to use 5,000 Hamamatsu PMTs, and then produced in Japan, and 15,000 NLVT PMTs that are produced in China. There are advantages and disadvantages in the two. So the advantage of PMT is that it has a quite large, or it has a larger quantum efficiency. So this means that the efficiency of converting photons into photoelectrons and so producing signal. And then the Hamamatsu are really really good in the time measurements. This means that we can reconstruct more precisely the position of the of our energy deposit or the interaction, if you want. You see here that the PMT is covered, and especially there are a lot of like, for example, this acrylic cover and or the steel cover that protect the PMT and avoid some problems that we had already in the past with using PMTs. And then this is once we when they are installed over this the surface of our sphere, we actually what we do is that we connect every three PMTs to an underwater box. This is a metallic box that stay in the water pool, and which contains all the front end electronics. All the readout is inserted here. And then we have a cable that is go out and go to the surface where we have the DRQ. And this is cables that can be up to 100 meters. So there are a lot of redundancy and reliability tests to make the system work. And at the end, we have this 5,000 underwater box to floating in there, not floating, but it's in the water. And for the small PMT, the situation, they are small, but the situation is still, is also complicated in the sense we have 25,000 of these small PMT to insert in the sphere to install. Each of these PMT is 40 times smaller than the large PMT. This means that they also collect 40 times less photons. So this can be seen is an advantage actually, because it allows to have a different way of operation of the PMT. So we can really count the photons, because each of these PMT will basically see only one or two photons most of the time. And they will not be affected by saturation like the large PMT. So this provides a complementary measurement with respect to the large PMTs. In this case, the installation is done in a different approach. We don't have, we have still an underwater box, but this time we connect 128 PMTs for each underwater box. And each electronics board can read the signals from this 128 PMT. And this is the performance. We have tested all of these performances, and okay, you see here some plots, but I'm not discussing them. We can come back if needed. We can look at them. Then going fast on the other systems, we have a muon veto that we mentioned before, and to avoid muons, we have two systems. We have the water pool and we have the top tracker. This water pool, I already told you that there are 35,000 tons of ultra pure waters. And this is not just a complication for the installation, but the system itself, we have to foresee it. Water production circulation of the inside the pool. So this means that the water is circulating all around, all during the run of the detector, and we have is not shown here, but on surface we have a water production plants that produce 100 tons of water, of pure water per hour, and also provide the circulation of water inside this object, this pool, because we want to control the temperature by, we want a temperature of the water constant, 21 degrees. And also for the top tracker I mentioned already, we are using here the plastic scintillator of Opera, and we have actually we cover 60% of the surface of the water pool, and we the granularity of this top tracker allows really to reconstruct very precisely the direction of this the entering muon. Then for the scintillators, these are complex objects. We use something like similar to Daya Bay. And the big problem here in when building Juno instead of Daya Bay, or small or rather previous liquid scintillator detector, is that we are really constructing something much bigger. So this means that we have to choose a liquid scintillator that has a very long attenuation length, so that our photons are not lost and they can reach the PMTs. So this is this was one of the main most serious requirements, and the other one is the low background. And we mentioned already that we want very low radioactivities, and for this, to ensure this low radioactivity, we have a purification system on the surface. You see here a picture of a purification pilot plant that we use to study the liquid scintillator for Juno that is installed in Daya Bay. So you see here there is also a complex system of all this, how we purify the liquid scintillator. I don't know all the details of this, but it's there are several steps. And we have also a second, another detector here that is called OSIRIS, that I'm zooming here, that is, if you want, this is somehow could be an independent experiment by itself. In terms of complexity, there is everything that you would have in a liquid scintillator experiment. This is 17 tons of liquid scintillator with 64 photon multipliers, a water pool around. So this is a complete system, and it will allow to monitor and to the radioactivity level in the liquid scintillator during the filling and the circulation. And this has been designed so that the monitoring will require less than a few days to reach the sensitivity needed for Juno. So so far I've presented the detector parts, and there is of course one key element, that is the calibration. So let's say in a general experiment, what you do is that you have your number of photoelectrons, and then you want to convert in energy. And to do this, you typically have a calibration constant. So you say a given number of photoelectrons corresponds to a certain number of MeV of energy deposit. So this is a general approach. The reality is typically typically different. So in what you have typically is that you have some non-linearities, and you see here the case of Juno. In this plot, you see the visible energy as divided through one as a function of gamma energy, the two energy, and you see that this is not a constant, this is not equal to one, but as this shape. So here, each point is a radioactive source that emits light in these energies. And so this is the first non-linearity that we have to deal with, and it's basically due to effects in the liquid scintillator. So it's really the liquid scintillator and the quenching effect inside it. And then we have some other effects that comes from the detector. So this can be of two types, can be instrumental, so can be the PMT, for example, that are not, or the electronics that introduce some small non-linearity effects. And then we have this geometrical effect that is shown here, where we basically, basically what this plot tell us is it gives us the light yield, the number of photoelectrons per MeV, as a function of the distance from the center of the sphere. And you see that when you go very close to the border of the sphere, we have some deviation in the or some differences in the light, the emitted light, and this is because of the PMTA location, because there are some shadowing effect, because you can have some total reflection on the sphere and so on. So there are all these physical, all these geometrical effects that we also want to take into account when we convert the number of photoelectrons into energy. And for doing this, of course, we have a very, let's say, a complicated program for calibration, and we also take advantage of the using of two different PMT systems. So here is the idea of the all the calibration that we plan to do. So we have several types. We have here this is the sphere of Juno. Okay, so we have here first calibration that is this called automatic calibration unit, in which we insert basically a source that can be either a radioactive source or a pulsed laser. And it reached the center and we can calibrate with this source. Then we have this loop system that are here shown in blue and pink that allows to test some position, so some position, intermediate position in the liquid scintillator volume. We have also this green guide in which we can, that goes around the sphere here, and it also allowed the calibration, so there will be a source that is pushed around this guide. And then we have this type of submarine that is the more flexible one, because it basically can go everywhere, and it also has so this allow for a calibration in three dimensions, and also has also a camera so that we can also look inside the central detector of this sphere. You see here also all the type of calibration that we want to use, and the program is under definition, but we have some of these runs that are done weekly and some other that are done monthly. So once this calibration performance is done, here I show you just the results of the expected performance, let's say, so what we expect in terms of energy resolution and in energy bias after the calibration. So this is the energy resolution. I told to you at the beginning of the talk that the goal is to reach this 3%. And actually, in general, what you can write your energy resolution in this way. So you have the typical stochastic term that comes from, that is follows a Poissonian. And this is the term that we want to reduce by increasing, for example, the number of PMTs, the coverage, by having as much as possible light inside our detector, or increase the quantum efficiency of our PMTs. So this is the stochastic term. And then we have some terms that are actually due to some systematic effects, like the non-linearities that we were mentioning before, or some detector effects like the dark noise in the PMTs and so on. So this is the shape, in any case, that we can get. This is one possibility. That there are, of course, other work going on to try to optimize the calibration position, or try to also make some combined studies about using all the calibration sources, the data together, to try to optimize even further this energy resolution. And you see on the right side that in terms of bias, we really don't have a lot of, we really don't have bias. So this is good news. Finally, I want to finish with this detector description by talking about this let's say, small detector that is close to the Taishan reactor that I mentioned to you, that is sometimes in a neutron experiment, we want to have a near detector. This is the case of Tau. This is a one-ton size liquid scintillator detector, and this is placed very close at something like 30 meters from the Taishan reactor. And the idea is from on one side to provide a measurement of the neutrino flux at the source, let's say at the source, and on the other side it provides also a very precious information, especially for nuclear database and monitoring of the nuclear reactors, and which are really something that is not easy to get. And this is, Tau will really be do a great job there because it will reach 1% energy resolution. So it's 1.5%. So that's really, many people are waiting for these new databases. And then we have also, it can also do this sterile search, sterile neutrino search that has been probably mentioned in the previous days. So you can find most of this, a lot of details on Tau here in this paper. So now here I finish with the detector. And let me check. Okay. So now I have a few slides to talk about the physics program and what Juno can do. So now you can find a lot of details here in these two papers. There is the first one that was the yellow book, and then there is a recent update with the detector. It's a challenging job to talk about the physics program of Juno because there are actually a lot of things that Juno can do and that they go beyond the measurement of the mass ordering or the oscillation parameters. There are, given the size and the resolution of Juno, we can really do many, many things from geoneutrinos, atmospheric neutrinos, this astrophysics, and then we have this exotic physics that we can do. And this is really, really many, many things. And I cannot, of course, talk about all of them. So I selected only a few.
Marie?
Yes?
Just in case it goes, I mean, within the scope of the talk, I just posted in the chat a question from YouTube that may be in the line of the astrophysics and supernova, but yeah. You decide
okay. When it's okay. You are lucky supernova there. You or the person who makes the question. So let's start with the main goal of Juno. This is the determination of the mass ordering. I have here a slide just to explain the basic idea of how we can measure this mass ordering, because I was not sure if you had time or to discuss about this in the previous days. So the basic scheme that you follow for measuring this mass ordering is that you have, let's assume your data, as precise as possible. We said already that we have some strict requirements on the precision in the energy, and these are the black points here that you see in this plot. And then what you do is to fit this data with a function or with your oscillation using the hypothesis of a normal ordering or an inverted ordering. So you do these two independent fits. And then you calculate this, you perform these test statistics where you basically calculate this delta chi square comparing these two hypotheses. And what you, this term here gives you the sensitivity in measuring this mass ordering. So for example, in this plot, we were assuming the black dots, of course, these are fake data. We don't have the detector yet, so these are simulated data. We assumed we simulated data like in the universe, neutrinos were mass order, were in normal ordering. And we fit this data with the normal ordered and the inverted ordered. And we get this delta chi square that is shown here in this plot. You basically compare this the black line that is the normal ordering and it has the minimum of chi square and with the case of inverted ordering, and you see that here you have this difference, and this difference gives you the sensitivity in measuring the mass ordering. What we do is typically to study this delta chi square under different conditions or under different, for example, we can use it to design the detector or to optimize the detector. So this is the important plot here. This gives you the mass ordering sensitivity of Juno. as a function of the energy resolution, as a function of the luminosity, or if you want, the number of events. This means here that on the x-axis, the number one corresponds to 100,000 events, that is 6 years of data. And here, each line here is a iso delta chi square contour, so it gives you the delta chi square, basically. So if you see that you can look at your energy resolution, we say that we want a 3% energy resolution. So in this plot, this means that with 6 years of data, we can do a little bit better than 3 sigma of sensitivity. If we want, with the same energy resolution, we want to reach the 4 sigma, that is this curve here, then we will need about 10 years of data. But this is, the main message here, the one that we hope to reach, is that really in 6 years, we can give with more than 3 sigma of sensitivity, we can really tell which is the mass ordering of neutrinos. Of course, a similar study has been done to try to find the optimal distance of the detector and also to be sure that we don't destroy our sensitivity by placing the detector in the wrong position. So, for example, in this plot, you see a similar study, but in this case, we have on the x-axis, we have the distance of our detector from the nuclear reactor. And you see that we get the maximum sensitivity here around the 50 kilometers. And the other important plot is here on the bottom, where we studied the impact of having different nuclear reactors. So compared to previous experiments, here we are using, I mentioned to you, 6 nuclear reactors in one of the nuclear power plant and 2 nuclear reactors in other. In the Taishan nuclear power plant. So this means that these two flux, the flux that comes from these 2 nuclear power plants, can overlap and somehow cancel out this fast oscillation that we want to observe. So you see this effect here in this plot. So this plot gives you the delta chi square as a function of the relative difference between the 2 baselines. So here it's what this plot tells you is that really Juno has to be at 53 kilometers or 52 kilometers at the same distance in any case from each of the 2 nuclear power plants. A difference in these 2 baseline of about more than 500 meters or even 1 kilometer will destroy our sensitivity to the mass ordering. And this is really something that is something important to keep in mind. And is also, we studied also the impact of having other, of the other nuclear reactors that are in China that are quite far away. So they will not have a significant effect in our sensitivity. The other thing that I want to mention here is something that is probably obvious, is that, of course, once we have a so big detector with so many data and so precise resolution, we are able to distinguish between the blue and the red modulation, we can, of course, measure also this theta 1-2 parameters, the delta m21, and also the parameters that are related to theta 1-3. And actually, you see here in this plot how we can improve our resolution or our precision on these parameters. This is for all the 4 parameters. You have one curve as a function of the time. So this black line is what we can do in 6 years of data. So in basically for most of these parameters, we can reach a sensitivity that is smaller or a precision that is smaller than 0.6%. And now today for these parameters, we are at the order of a few percent. So this means that Juno in 6 years can improve these parameters. So also the PM&S matrix by a factor between 5 and 10. So now I change topic. It's and we move to the supernova that is actually I chose a second topic just because it also imposes some constraint on the detector construction and also on the on the design of the detector more than in the detector construction. What Juno can do in this will be competitive on the worldwide level is the detection of core collapse supernova. These core collapse supernova are neutrinos that or are basically some explosion of stars that have a mass bigger than 8 times the mass of the sun. And you see in this plot the supernova 1987A, that was detected in 1987. You see here the supernova when it's when we have this explosion. It's actually really, really a luminous object during the explosion, and it can even be more bright than the full galaxy. So these are objects that we have seen several times in the history. But it's SN1987 is the first and the only supernova that we have detected with neutrinos. The thing that I am showing this plot is that you can see clearly that there is a huge amount of light that comes from this object. Supernova 1987A was in the Magellanic Cloud, so quite close to us. And this is all the light that you see in this picture is only less than 1% of the energy released by the explosion. 99% of this energy is actually going into the neutrinos. So this is the reason why this type of object are really interesting, because it's the only way we can, or most of the energy and the information also about core collapse supernova is coming in neutrinos. And the other reason is that neutrinos are the only particle that can actually escape the nucleus of this compact core object. And so they are also the only one that can tell us what's going on inside the supernova during the explosion. The only problem of this type of events is that they are very rare. As I said, this is the only one that we have detected, SN1987 with neutrinos. And we have some estimates of the rate of such an explosion in our galaxy. And this is between 1 and 3 per century. So you can guess that it's we have to be lucky to detect it. And it's once we have detected, it's once in a life, we will not have a second shot. So it's really important that our detector is built to detect these events. And here in this plot, I show you the flux, the neutrino flux that we expect from simulation. There are very complicated simulations that have been that are done by theoreticians, and these simulations are very complex because they have to put together really all type of physics from particle physics, fluid dynamics, convention movements, and nuclear physics. Nuclear equation of states with all the uncertainties that are related to this. There is also general relativity. These are quite really complex simulation. There are several models depending on the assumption that we have on this simulation, but all of them, they basically have these three phases. And what I would like that you get from this plot is the basically one information is the duration of such an explosion. It basically is only everything occurs in less than 10 seconds. So what we want to see, all these neutrinos and different neutrino flavor that we want to see, they only occurs in a few seconds, actually in basically the first 500 milliseconds. Then the flux is much less strong, and you see here the average energy. This answers the question of the on YouTube. We are the average energy is around 15 MeV. We can go up to 50 MeV. So this is the number of events that we expect in Juno is quite huge. If we consider an average or a reference supernova 10 kiloparsec, that means the center of the galaxy, we expect something like around 5,000 events in less than 10 seconds. Most of them, as I said before, is coming in the first 100 milliseconds. This is a huge number, and it is challenging in terms, especially in terms of DRQ and electronics. So, because as I said before, we have only one possibility in our life to detect such a type of events. So that's, you don't want to lose any information. We will be happy to detect this neutrino, but as many information we can get, the better is to distinguish between different models of a neutrino explosion, and also to understand particle physics or fundamental physics in these ambients that are really extreme ambients. Then, of course, if we look to the extreme case, the closest supernova to us could be Betelgeuse, that is at 200 parsec. In that case, the number of events will be really huge. Surely we will not be able to deal with Betelgeuse, because then we will have something like 10 to 7 events from IBD in less than in a few milliseconds, 100 milliseconds. So this is a number. But okay, so we have this, we will be able to detect even closer a supernova without issue. We will have all the problems related to pileups and reconstruction, but this is but the design of the detector has been done in order to deal with such an event. And we also have a dedicated trigger that is a dedicated system also from the hardware point of view. So there is independent electronics and independent computing powers that deals with these events, not only with core collapse supernova, but actually it wants to extend to any transient source. The idea, in fact, is to lower the trigger threshold, so to go down to 50 keV instead of the 200 keV that is the current energy threshold for Juno. And also it has also implemented something like online monitoring of the rate of events. I'm like simplifying a bit the type of event monitoring system, which allow to really recognize also faint transient sources that can be can happen also in, for example, in neutron mergers or in other astrophysical phenomena. And this multi-messenger trigger will also be part of this of these alert systems that are under discussion at the worldwide level between the different experiments, all the actual neutrino and observatory and gamma rays or gravitational wave observatory to try to have a multi-messenger detection of astrophysical objects. So now I will really quickly flash on two other topics and then then I will stop. One thing is the neutrinos from the sun. I told you that the neutrinos from the sun are our most powerful source, natural source. And we have studied the solar neutrinos since decades. We have different, these neutrinos are emitted in the thermal processes in a thermal reaction inside the sun, and there are different chains. And we have, of course, a different flux depending on the neutrino production chain. From the experimental point of view, of course, the most complicated part is either to detect low energies events or to detect low flux. Here, just as a reference, you have the proton-proton chain that is basically 90% of the neutrino emission from the sun that is has a flux of 10 to 10 neutrinos per centimeter square per second, and the bottom eight, that is one of our goal, is six order of magnitude smaller. So the goal with the large volume of Juno, we can actually aim to do this type of measurement. So this measurement of the beryllium 7 and the bohrium 8. And this data from the solar neutrinos can also, of course, be used to do some delta M to 1 measurements, and also to try to understand if we measure the CNO spectrum to try to understand the solar metallicity problem. So this means the heavy elements in the sun. And here I will not enter in a lot in details of these plots. This is, I want just to mention that for this type of detection, we will use the neutrino elastic scattering, electron elastic scattering. And this is a very challenging measurement because we have in this region of interest for neutrino, for solar neutrinos, we have a lot of backgrounds that comes from the radioactivities. This is all the requirements, the strict requirements that I was mentioning to you before that are even stricter than what we require for mass ordering studies. So we really need to reach this level of radioactivity contamination. And but we did studies and we can actually, in a, this is a plot with 6 years of the, in 10 years of data. And you see here the reconstruction of the boromate spectrum. And we can also see in this plot the measurement of the delta M square that is here shown in the band that can be used as a cross check of what we measured in vacuum by using the nuclear reactors. Then there is the, we can also do this, the measurement of the atmospheric neutrinos. This has been mentioned already in the previous talk, so I will skip probably the slides just to, you heard already that we can, we produce neutrinos in, by the interaction of cosmic rays in the atmosphere. And from this interaction, we what we expect is something like a ratio between the neutrino mu and the neutrino and electron neutrinos of a factor two because of this decay chain. And the advantage of this atmospheric neutrino is that we can detect neutrinos from both the top and the bottom of the experiment, let's say. And we can recognize them using this the direction of the zenith angle. So what we can do in June again is the main advantage is this huge volume that we have with the high resolution detection. And what we measure is in this case is the neutrino, the, we can measure the charged current and the charged current and the neutral charged neutral current interactions of these neutrinos in order to distinguish between the electron neutrinos and the muon neutrinos. In particular, what we look at in the detector is that in the case of an electron neutrinos, we produce an electron which will give something very a very short track in our detector, something that actually looks like a point-like energy deposit. In the case of muons, the muon that is produced by the interaction will make a big track in the detector, so we can distinguish between these two particles and we can reconstruct this the energy spectrum. Here you see the energy scale just to just since we are changing quite significantly the energy range compared to what I've shown so far. So we are not talking anymore about MeV, but here the scale is GeV. So we can, we actually limit our search to 20 GeV in this plot because of analysis so that we can conditions. And you can say this region, the with the data set of Juno, we can really improve a lot the uncertainties on this flux. And this is a region where we have some data from Supercamucan and Frejus, but they are not really, there are some discrepancies there. So this is a really interesting region to investigate. And then the geoneutrinos that I mentioned to you before as a source of background, and here is actually something that is really interesting, especially interesting for geophysicists. Actually, we have a good fraction, a quite a big fraction of collaborators that are geophysicists, and they are interested by Juno only because of geoneutrinos. You know that the Earth has is a dynamic object with a very high heat flow. You have seen, you know, with earthquakes, volcanoes, and so on. And most of this heat flow comes from the some is a radiogenic origin, it has a radiogenic origin and comes from also from the decays of uranium and thorium chain or from potassium 40 that are in the crust or in the mantle. So what we can do with JUNE is that we can detect these electron antineutrinos that are produced inside the HER. And the flux that we expect is extremely low, of course, compared to other sources that we have seen so far, but we still have some significance to detect them. And so we can use then this information in the spectrum of this flux of geoneutrinos to understand the evolution of the Earth, the composition, and all the convention in the mantle. Maybe the things that I find nice, at least to say now in a general talk, is that JUNO can do really a lot of in this geophysics field, especially because it can collect about 400 events per year. And you compare this with all the events that we have accumulated so far by all the experiments, all the neutrino experiments that are running. And you see that in 1 year, we can basically have 3 times more events than what we have so far. So this, you can understand that for the study of the Earth formation and evolution is a real jump in this. In terms of also all the information and the uncertainties that we can on this flux will be a really improvement, big improvement. So I have just a couple of slides on the detector status. That's not so much, but it's important because, as I said, the JUNO is under construction. There are a lot of things that we can do, but the question can remain, so when? So now, as I mentioned to you, the collaboration started in 2014, and we wanted JUNO underground. There was nothing there already existing, so most of the time has been dedicated to the digging of the underground lab. And basically this work is completed. We have also built the surface facilities. You see here some nice pictures, like here the access tunnel during the construction of the lab. You see here the water pool, just as a reference, this small hole here where the lights are coming is the same here. So you can have the feeling of the size. This was also the water pool, another picture of the water pool, and here is from the top. And now we are at the phase of putting some concrete around the hole, around the preparation of the wall to host the water pool, and then we will start the construction. So the time scale. Before going there, in the meantime, we are proceeding, of course, with the preparation of all these subsystems that I mentioned to you. These are all of them are complex objects, so we need to produce, for example, for the PMTs. We have finished the production of these 40,000 PMTs. They are basically almost all tested. You see here some picture of the testing of the large PMTs. And here we have the test bench that we use for the testing of the small PMTs. And there have been studies about the acrylic sphere with some prototypes. This huge acrylic sphere. This is only the 4 meter prototype. So you can imagine how big is the real one. And then there have been studies in parallel for finalizing the calibration system, the top tracker that is, plastic scintillator comes from Opera, but the electronic has been redone. And all the liquid scintillator studies and testing and purification system development, these have been already mentioned. And all the material have been radio assayed. So this is the installation, the filling procedure. Basically, I think that they are defined, but we have the JUNO meeting ongoing this week so that we will get some more advanced news, at least I will get it in a few days. And so the schedule, as I said, everything started in 2014. We are now here. Maybe to be fair, compared to the original plan, we have a couple of years of delay. But this was on one side because we had some digging issues. And then the COVID-19 has also added a 1 year of delay. So we plan to start installation next year. So probably we will have data in the end of 2023. So in the so far, this is the time schedule. So time is approaching. So maybe soon we will start this data taking. So this is my just a summary. It's probably the message here from this talk is that you don't need to remember everything, but it's really an June is going to be a really unprecedented detector in liquid scintillator detector in terms of size and precision. And there is a really amazing scientific program behind that is of course the measuring of the mass ordering that is quite challenging. But we have all the other physics that I tried to sketch quickly or to flash in astrophysics, gyrotrinos, and other exotic physics that have not discussed here. So for the civil construction, I told you is everything is underway. And so in the maybe we will finish next year already with this construction and we'll have data soon. Thank you for the attention. And I don't know if you have questions or if there is anything, any other question coming on YouTube.
Okay, thanks a lot, Mari, for this beautiful talk. And yeah, we are looking forward to the data taking. So that's gonna be very exciting. What's the expected time, I mean, for commissioning once you have completed the installation?
So we have not, I have not a precise number in the sense that the detector filling is quite, it takes some time. It's a huge sphere and the filling is complicated. So for the filling, we have an estimate of 6 months. There were questions in case we, or there were discussion about if we can take data or start some commissioning during the filling, or at least once the filling, part of the filling is done. But I guess that a commissioning of few months will be, we can expect something like this. After completing the detector.
Okay. Thank you. And how does this detector compare to Hyper-K regarding the geoneutrinos and supernova?
So Hyper-K is a big detector. It's actually bigger than much bigger than Juno. And it's in terms of supernova, there is something more that comes from Hyper-K. They are both parts of news. So we expect, I don't remember exactly the number, but it's a Hyper-K thing that can expect up to between five and 10 more events than Juno. The detection techniques is different. And especially if you, one of the four supernova, the advantage of having two independent detectors is that you actually can open to different detection channels. So I talked about IBD most of the talk, but there are other channels that you can use to detect, for example, the neutrino electron scattering or the neutrino proton scattering that access to different flavors. And the main idea of here of using Juno and Hyper-K, for example, is to really compare different interaction channels. And the other reason why there is all this, this is not only Hyper-K and Juno, but it's also the general aim of this new program, this networking of all the neutrino experiments, including Duna. Duna also can do measurements of supernova neutrinos. This is really to try also to get together information about directions and different channel sensitivities and different systematic uncertainties, because when you change your detector, you can also get rid of systematic uncertainties. Then for geoneutrinos, I'm not sure about hyper-K, mostly because of the energy threshold. But I guess that if with IBD they can further increase the statistics. So that's the volume of hyper-K will surely give a lot of information more. Yeah.
Okay, thanks a lot, Marie. And what's your bet regarding when is the next supernova?
I hope not in the next 2 or 3 years. Let's say I would hope for 7 years.
Yeah.
Something like not too old for the detector, not too quick because we are not sure if we understood everything. And so something in 7 years. I would like, that's what I would like.
Okay, it's not okay. 7 years then. Perfect.
Then also it's good because hyper-K will be there if there are no delays. So that's... there is no competition in this.
I know. Yeah. If there is a supernova, there will be enough for everybody.
Yes, and as many as we have, then it's even better.
Okay, well, we thank Mari for this beautiful talk, and yeah, we are receiving many people saying that they enjoy the talk. So thank you so much. And I hope we are able to meet in person soon again.
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Marie. Okay, so we will now stop for a lunch break. And then we will resume at 2:30 Buenos Aires time. Vamos entonces a hacer ahora el intervalo del almuerzo y volvemos a las 2:30 con la charla de Elena. Así que nos vemos en un rato. Hasta luego.